happened with the prevailing theory of the sheriff's office. So my intention is to inquire on the subject briefly, and it will go to determination for untruthfulness that the sheriff's office determined that his employment needed to end because he lacked the credibility necessary to testify in court. And again, this informs why he would conform his report to the prevailing hypothesis of the sheriff's office. It goes to his credibility, it goes to his bias, and it informs his motive to say things that are not accurate from the perspective of the defense. And that's why we intend to elicit this information. Because of the language in 608 about the discretion of the court, I wanted to bring it up knowing that this is sort of radioactive kind of information. And again, it's not with pleasure that we come after him for having at one point been terminated for untruthfulness. Many years have passed, but it was closer in time to 2012. And I think that it goes to why he is saying things, or why he said things in about 2012 that we think are misrepresentations.
Mr. Champagne.
Thank you, Judge. This is my witness. I do appreciate counsel bringing this up prior to his testimony. Most of what Mr. Moran recited, I believe, is accurate. He was terminated for untruthfulness. It's my understanding actually related to the Human Resources Department and misleading them about the insurance status of his soon-to-be ex-wife. He was going through a messy divorce. I think the allegation regarding stalking some type of ex-girlfriend or girlfriend while on duty, I don't think is relevant to truthfulness. I really don't think most of the actual details are relevant to his testimony or cross-examination. I don't dispute that Mr. Moran may want to and probably should be able to inquire regarding his termination and was it related for untruthfulness, but I don't think the details are something that need to be inquired upon. I also think it's a real stretch to argue that this somehow informs the testimony that he's giving regarding this case. He was the initial officer from the Bayfield Marshal's office that took the report on the afternoon of the 19th. He had no further involvement in this case at all. So the idea that there's some type of pressure exerted that would force him to somehow conform with the prevailing theory, as Mr. Moran described it, I think is a bridge too far. So we don't object to inquiring were you in fact terminated for untruthfulness, but we do object to the remainder of what Mr. Moran has described.
Mr. Moran, I'll let you get into the fact he was terminated for not being truthful in the sheriff's office determination and that they were very concerned about his ability to testify at trial, but I don't want to go into any details.
Understood.
Okay, with that, bring him up. All right, we can be seated. And where's our witness? He's coming?
Right there,
Jeff. Okay. My name is Mr. Vreeland. Just go ahead and have a seat. You are still under oath.
Hello, sir. I'd like to pick up close to where we left off, but first I want to circle back to one of the questions I asked you before the motion break. So you had talked about the approximate distance from the Redwine residence to the dam, and I think you approximated close to 9 miles. Is that right?
Yeah, 9 miles. Probably a little less than that, but
less. give us your best approximation.
I'll still stay with that 9 because I don't know exactly.
Right. So roughly.
Roughly 9 miles.
9 miles. Okay. And then I had asked you if the defendant had said anything about how Dylan Redwine might have got it. Remember that line of questions?
Mm-hmm.
I realized that.
John, if I may, I understand the orienting of the witness, but we're going a couple of chapters back.
It's just direct. He can do this. It's okay.
Well, maybe not. I don't know what the actual question is. Go ahead, Mr. Johnson. Yes, Your Honor. And I had asked you if you recall if the defendant said how Dylan Rose got there. You recall that?
Yes.
And you said you didn't recall?
Correct.
Would it be helpful to take a look at a report in the case from the Fulbright that dates all the way back to 2013? It's been about 8 years.
Absolutely helpful.
So I'm on discovery page 705. May I approach, Your Honor?
Yes.
Mr. Boone, I'm just going to direct your attention to that third to last paragraph, and then on separate questions to that last paragraph, if you could just read those yourself.
Okay. Thank you.
Does that help to refresh your memory from?
Can you turn that microphone towards you, please?
Yes, Your Honor. Did that help to refresh your memory from those years ago?
Absolutely. Okay.
Did the defendant make a statement to you about how Dylan Redwine would have got to the dam at the reservoir to the spot that he said he might have gone fishing?
Yes, he did.
How did he say he would have gotten there?
He would have walked.
And that, as you testified, one way was approximately 9 miles?
Correct.
How far would that have been round trip had Dylan gone fishing there?
18 miles.
And then I had asked you a question, too, about whether the defendant made any statements about if Dylan Redwine had a cell phone. Remember that?
Correct.
Did it refresh your memory to review that report on that as well?
Yes, he had his cell phone.
Now, I want to move ahead to where we left off. And if I remember correctly, we were talking about you had procured the pillowcase with gloves and put it into a Ziploc bag.
Correct.
And then you had started to testify about what you did with that pillowcase, correct?
Correct.
And then I think earlier I had asked you about the area of Vallecito in the summer and in November and how it was different.
Correct.
Remember that? So in the summer you'd said it was pretty busy?
Yes.
How is that different in November up on that dead end road, 7500?
I would say at that time the population's about half. And then we don't have the tourists during the winter.
So is there any, while you're up there doing your work, is there any through traffic on that dead end road?
No, there's.
And that campsite is closed?
Correct.
So when you went to do your work in this case, can you just explain to the jury what you did with that pillowcase to start your search efforts for Dylan Redwine?
Okay. Like I said earlier, I give the scent article to a dog, let the dog take a good inhalation on it, and then I put her to work. And in most cases, I'll start a small circle and get wider and wider and wider until she picks up on a direction of travel. And that's what I did. Small property. I worked a little yard on the north side, and I got nothing, and then I worked around the house and just kept getting concentrically bigger with my search pattern.
Is this generally referred to as trailing?
Yes.
And then were you able to develop a trail from the odor on the pillowcase as you were doing this circular?
No, and I kept going back and working it. Eventually, I got a little bit of indication from my dog. Especially when I went out towards the cattle guard. So the front of the house before the road, generate 500, there's a small cattle guard on his driveway. And it was in that area that we picked up on a little bit of scent there, which took me a little way south on 500, but then it dissipated immediately, which is unusual. Being that fresh, it should have been a very positive indication by the dog.
Your Honor, I'm going to object to this testimony and further testimony on the subject by this witness. The prosecution affirmatively stated to the court at a July 27, 2019 hearing that Judge Mr. Moran is correct. He's not called to trial on this issue. He hasn't been qualified as an expert. This is 702 information, testimony by experts with specialized knowledge, which this clearly is, need to be endorsed as such. And I object to this line of testimony and further testimony on this issue, and would move to strike what we've just heard. It requires 702 knowledge, which has not been properly endorsed.
Okay, first of all, in terms of what was stated in July 27th of 2019, I don't have any memory, and I'm sorry about that, but it's just the way it is. In terms of him being qualified, there hasn't been a foundation laid under Brooks to allow this type of testimony yet. So to that extent, I'm going to grant the motion. But I'd like to hear a response from you about what Ms. Moran just said.
Yes, Your Honor. I'm not going to ask for expert testimony. I'm simply asking what he did in his search and rescue efforts. I have one more question, and that's simply, did it lead anywhere? And then I intend to follow up with a witness who went through that same hearing referenced by Mr. Moran, was found to be reliable and admissible, and I'm going to present that evidence through that witness. But this is context for that.
And is it a trailing dog, or is it?
Yes, Your Honor.
All right, I'll let you ask one more question.
Thank you, Your Honor. You talked about that distance. Ultimately, were you able to use that pillowcase to find the trail for Dylan Redwine?
Ultimately, no.
Okay, thank you. And so what search efforts did you do after you were unable to continue on the course with the pillowcase?
That same night or?
Yes, that same night.
I started working in a grid fashion to the east of the house through some private properties and ultimately to the river, the stream, which is not that far away. And I wound up working until probably 12:30 that evening.
Did more people come to assist you in your search?
A few others, yes. Another dog handler. I had a helper. We try to have a helper with a dog handler. They can keep eyes on things because you're concentrating on your dog's indication and ear twitches and head jerks and things like that. So they prevent me from, you know, walking off a cliff type scenario. But yeah, so another dog handler was there that evening.
Were there also, you said a few people helping you, were there also people just visually looking in the woods with flashlights, calling out, things like that?
There was a few people. I can't recall because I get very focused on working my dog. So I don't know how many SAR folks showed up, SAR search and rescue. I don't know how many showed up that night.
And when it got dark out, did you begin to become concerned for the welfare of the missing?
Oh, absolutely, because it was getting chillier. Uh-huh. There was ice forming on the rocks along the stream bank, which is a, you know, slip hazard and easy to fall and whatever.
You still have your down coat on as you were searching?
Oh, absolutely.
And then you and the other searchers that had joined you, did you say what time a night you had searched until you finally stopped?
Yeah, I was the last one to leave the scene, and it was, you know, 12:30, quarter to one someplace. I got home around 1 o'clock, and it's about a 20-minute drive.
Okay. And then would it refresh your memory as to the exact time if I were to show you a report from back in 2013 to Investigator Goldbright?
Sure.
May I approach, Your Honor?
You may.
Yeah, 1 o'clock. That generally consistent with what you testified to?
Yes.
Yeah. And then what were your concerns as 1 o'clock a.m. Rolled around?
It was a survivable night for somebody that age with a little, you know, lack of a better word, common sense. But he would have had a miserable night out on his own. Or if he had slipped on the icy rocks on the river, and then knocked out or swept into the water, that's a whole different story there.
Fair to say it was a pretty dangerous situation.
Yes, it's a fast-moving stream, and if somebody that size would have slipped and fell in, he would have been washed downstream.
And then also, just generally speaking, not having a coat in that temperature
exactly.
Out there. Was that concerning as well?
Absolutely.
As you were working that night, did you ever have contact with the defendant after your initial conversation with him?
No, I did not.
Was that unusual to you?
Absolutely.
Can you just explain a little bit to the jury, please?
So typically, from my personal experience with family members of a missing child.
Mr. Vreeland, pardon me for a moment. Your Honor, objection. This is calling for speculation and what sounds an awful like profiling material that would be inadmissible, even with a witness properly endorsed or expertise of the type that's being testified to right now. This is mind reading. Absent the proper qualification, foundation, and endorsement as an expert in the profile of people whose children are missing.
I don't see this as being expert testimony. You can certainly cross-examine. You can cross-examine any other search and rescue people that come to testify if you want, but I think it's appropriate testimony. Go ahead.
So you can continue, Mr. Vreeland, explaining to the jury what was unusual about the defendant's behavior.
So from my personal experience, being in the same situation many times with family members, the parent, they never want to leave our side, and it can be, I don't want to say annoying because I respect what they're going through, but they get in the way. So, I didn't have any of that. And they're constantly wanting to know what we found, if we found anything, what we're doing, why we're not trying hard, or why we're not staying all night, things to that effect.
Did you ever see him come out of the house at all to check in?
I did not.
You had testified already that you were there around 1 o'clock.
Yes.
Were you close to his house around 11 p.m.?
My car was parked directly across from his house.
At this time, Your Honor, I'm just going to ask to publish what's been previously admitted as People's 24.
All right, that's fine.
Mr. Vreeland, do you recognize the home on the TV screen marked as People's Exhibit 24?
I do.
Whose house is that?
That was the Redwine residence at the time.
And is this a similar vantage point of the side of the house you would have been viewing when you set up across the street?
Absolutely.
You may have been a little further back, but generally speaking, this is what you're looking
Correct.
At. What did you notice, if anything, at 11 o'clock p.m. the night of November 19th, 2012?
Lights in the house being turned off.
Was that notable to you at that time?
Very notable to me, and again, from experience, I find that parents typically...
Your Honor, if I may, I understand the court's ruling, but we're drifting off again into specialized knowledge that comes from experience, that is specialized experience and objection. And if it pleases the court, I'm happy to just have a standing objection to this type of information from this witness because it's improperly endorsed. I don't want to interrupt you to be here, so.
That would be very pleasing to the court. So there's a standing objection, and it's overruled for the same reason as I stated before.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, Mr. Vreeland, you were explaining something, but let me first be specific and walk through this and then let you explain. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So pointing at the photograph there, is there a specific light that went off at 11 o'clock that you recall?
The outside porch light, which you can see on the upper, by the front door, off to the left.
Okay. And what about the lights inside the home? Did those...
Eventually, all the lights were turned off.
By 11 o'clock?
Around 11 o'clock.
Did that surprise you? And I'm not talking about your experience yet. But just in general, given the circumstances you were in that night, did that surprise you to see the lights go off in the house?
Absolutely. Most people tend to turn every light on and make their house a beacon so a missing person can find their way home, whether it be a spouse or a child.
So by a beacon, do you mean if, for example, someone's up in the woods because they've walked off?
Absolutely.
To go fishing?
We've had people honking their horn and, you know, trying to, in case the, you know, the person's up, you know, within hearing range.
And then if they are walking down trying to find the home.
Right, they'll be able to see it. It's a very dark area.
Okay. And but when you say very dark area, are there any streetlights?
There's absolutely no streetlights. And like you said before, half the homes are vacant that time of year.
So pitch black type
pitch
of thing.
Black.
Okay, hold on just a second. You guys are real close and sometimes talking over each other. We can't get a record that way. The jury has trouble understanding what's being said. So try and take a pause. I know that's not how you normally talk probably. But, the other thing, I just want to make my record a little clearer. I just don't find this to be specialized knowledge that is testifying about requiring expert attention. So go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. So what was your reaction seeing all the lights inside and outside the house go off at 11 o'clock?
Odd. Very odd.
Were you still working at that time?
I was.
And you talked about some of the conditions that were dangerous at that point. Is that why you continued to work out there?
Yes.
Was there a point in time finally when it got to be too much for the night and you broke off and started again in the morning?
Yeah, it just got too dangerous to be out there in the pitch black working off a headlamp down by the river.
Okay. And then just based on your life experience and your experience out doing this kind of work, have you ever seen anything like that before, the lights going out like that at 11 p.m.?
I have not.
And then what was decided about the plan moving forward after you were out there till 1 p.m. and then stopped for the evening?
I got a radio call from Ron Corcus, who's in charge of La Plata County Search and Rescue, and it said they were going to reconvene at 7 o'clock. And I wound up talking to him on the cell phone, and he asked if I would, they're going to meet at one of our firehouses down south, and he asked me if I could manage or IC the lake area and the volunteers that came up to the lake at 7 a.m.
What's the IC?
Incident Command.
Does that mean that you're in charge of the search operation up there?
Yes.
And then that next morning you mentioned around 7 a.m. How does that correspond with sunrise and when daylight roughly starts to come?
It starts getting light enough where you can work safely.
At 7?
Yeah.
And did you in fact respond up there at 7 a.m. and come up with a plan for the day?
I was much earlier.
You were earlier?
Yeah.
When did the search efforts resume the next day? This would be November 20th.
So. Yeah, it was approximately 7 o'clock. Volunteers. So it's an all-volunteer organization. People started showing up, and I just started giving out assignments based on different skill sets.
Okay. And did you continue to stage right across the street from the home?
Yes, I did.
Can you just talk to the jury a little bit about how many volunteers and what those assignments look like in general?
Yeah, I don't know the exact numbers that showed up to my location, but we had numerous search and rescue volunteers. We had the public come over to my command vehicle asking if they could help. If I knew them and I knew their skill sets, I actually had them checking out other places that they were familiar with and that we weren't, especially stuff up in the up on that cliff band we talked about earlier that today.
Did you have people from other members of search and rescue as some of those volunteers assisting you? Were there other members of search and rescue assisting that effort in the morning?
Yes, yes. And I actually, maybe after I was there half an hour, 45 minutes, one of our female members came over to me and she said she was assigned to me, which is a great help because she acted like a scribe and just kept track of where everybody was.
And did you also have members of the public assisting at some points in the search?
A few, yes.
And then did you have members of law enforcement assisting in the search as well?
They were there. I don't know what their role is in the morning because they have their own incident command person.
Okay. And by the time you were doing these searches on November 20th of 2012, is it fair to say that there were quite a few people involved?
There was. The first time I left the command area. After we stopped searching the north end of the lake, we bumped down to about where the general store was, and that's when I saw there was, you know, there's probably 30, 40 people there.
Okay.
Quite a few folks.
Were people looking in the woods?
People were looking in the woods. People were going door to door, knocking on doors, talking to people. If there was nobody home, they walked around the premises, looked in outbuildings, under buildings, crawl spaces, any place, you know, somebody could spend the night and try to get some sleep.
Was concern building as time passed?
Oh, absolutely. Every minute counts.
And then did you, without getting into too much detail, did you make further efforts at that pillowcase as well?
Yeah, I worked with that pillowcase until a further date that you're aware of.
Okay. And so you tried, that was one of the search efforts, was this item. You were hopeful you could use this item to find
it. I used it every day until later on.
Further distances than just in front of the home?
Yes.
Any success in finding a trail of Dylan with that pillowcase?
Nothing.
Now, we're talking about November 20th in the morning. Was there a point in time where you saw the defendant that morning?
Yeah, a little later in the morning. I don't know, maybe within an hour after I showed up. Could have been longer. He came outside and sat on the front porch. On it, there was a beach chair type folding chair there. He sat in that chair.
What was he doing in that chair?
It looked like he might have been drinking coffee or something.
Would you identify he? I think we can assume, but could you tell us who that was?
Excuse me?
You said he. He didn't give a name.
Oh, Mark Redwine.
Do you see Mark Redwine here in this courtroom?
Yes.
Okay. Where is he sitting and what's something he's wearing? Mr. Vreeland, in the courtroom, where is he sitting?
To my left.
And what's something he's wearing?
What's something he's wearing?
Yeah, like what color tie? So the record reflects.
A green tie, sorry.
Thank you. Judge, I would just ask that the record reflect Mr. Vreeland is indicating the defendant.
It will.
Thank you. And so, do you still have the pointer there?
Yeah.
Can you just show the jury where he came out to have his coffee that morning?
Right here on this little porch.
And then, if you could grab a seat, thank you. When he came out, these microphones get in the way sometimes, but they're very helpful to hear.
Yes.
So, sir, when he came out, were you still across the street set up as incident command?
I was.
Did he come to ask you any questions?
He did not.
Did he ask you for any updates on the search?
He did not.
Did you see him asking anyone else for updates on the search effort?
I did not see him ask anybody.
Did he ask to have a role, to get involved, to do anything to help with the search efforts?
He did not. Not to me, anyway.
Did his demeanor seem concerned or otherwise?
Objection to asking. Well, this is at a different time frame, I believe.
What was notable about his demeanor?
He showed no interest.
Did he seem concerned or did he seem unconcerned?
I would say he did seem not concerned.
Did that start to bother you at this juncture of the case?
Very unusual in my experience.
And you were out there looking for his son?
Correct.
Did it get to the point where it was frustrating for you?
I was it was a very busy morning, but when I did have time to reflect on that during that morning, yes.
Had you ever asked him to stay put in the home at any point during your search operation?
I did not.
Did you hear anyone else in your presence ask him to stay put during the search efforts?
I did not hear anybody ask that of him.
Even if that had been asked by him, would it still have been simple enough for him to cross this distance we're looking at to ask you some basic questions?
Right. Even if he was asked to stay put, it was 50 feet away from me.
And did you ever witness any of his demeanor in terms of being excited or pacing or nervous, anything like that?
I did not.
In all the years you've done search and rescue, did that cause concern for you?
Like I said earlier, it was just, to me, it was very unusual.
Now, did you continue search efforts throughout that day?
Yes, I did not stay at that location all day. Around noon, we moved that IC, and I went on to when I'm IC, I can't work my dog, so it was determined around noon that I could be released and work my dog, and that's when I went down to the general store.
Okay. And then did you continue in the search efforts in all the days that followed?
Yes, I did.
Did you ever have any success in those days in November and December of finding Dylan Redwine?
I did not.
And then how many days, how frequently were you involved in searches looking for Dylan in that time period?
I donated approximately 20 days per month all through the fall and all through the winter.
Was that similar? Were there others that were doing the same, doing searches in the area?
Well, I worked primarily with the detectives from the SO's office.
Okay. And were there law enforcement searches that went on as well?
There was.
Was there ever a focus on some of the bodies of water based on the information that you had received?
A couple times, our attention was drawn to the water. Once was at the dam earlier on, and then another time was at a stump on the east side of the lake. I don't recall. The stump situation might have been in April.
Then I asked you earlier about a fishing pole and whether it was mentioned missing.
Correct.
And I think your answer to me was you recall that was some point in time during.
Yeah, it came up. It wasn't directed at me. I heard it indirectly through law enforcement that Dylan's fishing pole that was in the garage was missing.
Okay. And that information, why was that information conveyed to you?
That may or may not have helped us confirm that he did, in fact, go fishing.
And you got that information that was conveyed to you as coming from the defendant?
Yes.
And then did that direct some of your searches to certain areas?
Absolutely.
Can you just talk to the jury about that a little bit?
Yes. So the night myself and Officer Potoff interviewed Mr. Redwine in his house, he told us he liked, Dylan liked to go fishing. That was one of his favorite things to do. And then when we heard about the pole, that sparked our interest and directed more attention to the lake, especially the dam, because Mr. Redwine mentioned that the dam was his favorite fishing area. So we directed a lot of efforts down towards the dam. We actually called in many people to help on that.
Did that continue for those months of the early investigation?
Early on, a lot of time, a lot of resources were dedicated. We brought in a dive rescue team out of New Mexico, things like that. So a lot of time.
I'm going to go back to People's Exhibit 23, Your Honor.
Can you publish?
Yes. Can you see the, or actually, I'm sorry, let me go to 22. On People's Exhibit 22, does this show the area that is the Vallecito Lake?
Yes, it does.
And is the dam on shown on here as well?
It is. Would you like me to?
Yes, please. If you could you just point to the jury what area that is that the dam is?
The dam we're talking about is right here. South end of the dam. South end of the lake.
Thank you, sir. And if that wasn't loud enough without the microphone, it was the south end of the lake.
Correct.
Now, you talked about a lot of efforts being done there. Is that a distinct and different area than Middle Mountain Road?
Yes.
And can you just talk about where those areas are in relation to each other while the jury has the map up?
So again, just for reference, this is County Road 500, this is Middle Mountain Road, and then the dam. So it's quite a long way.
Thank you, sir. So is it fair to say, based on what you've already testified to, that the search efforts were directed away in an area distinct from Middle Mountain Road?
Yes, sir.
Did that go on for several months?
Went on for a long time.
And is Middle Mountain Road, you talked about this a little earlier, but is that a difficult area to search once snow sets in and it gets to be wintertime?
It's very difficult. I spent a lot of days on snowshoe and cross-country skis up there trying.
But in terms of being able to find anything in snowpack or get any...
Yeah, it gets a lot of snow.
And are you able to get a large number of searchers up there to comb the woods, or is that just too difficult?
When there was snow, we didn't put anybody up there except myself.
Was there a point in the springtime when your attention was drawn to Middle Mountain Road as opposed to the reservoir?
Yes, there was.
Can you tell the jury about that?
At that time I was working on a at the request of the Sheriff's Department to check out an area on the east side of the lake. Should I point it?
Yes, please.
Okay. It was some point in early April that I was asked to come up to the lake to, with my dog, to search an area of interest, and that was up in here someplace. And I spent a few days up there looking around, grading off an area, and a report came in through one of the detectives that somebody just spotted Mark Redwine and his vehicle coming. Awesome.
Objection, Your Honor. This is
hold on. There's an objection. Yes, be quiet. Okay. Mr. Marin?
If somebody has spotted it, it's a CPA, so that it's totally unreliable. We object. We need to strike it. What has just been said about it, and you said the testimony about the rumor that's going on back then.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes, Your Honor. This goes to why the witness did what he did, and also we'll have a witness testifying to it in court as well.
Okay. You're overruled.
So, in terms of impacting your search efforts, you received information specifically about Mark Redwine coming down from Middle Mountain Road?
That's correct.
In his own vehicle?
That's what I was told.
Okay. How did that feel after you'd spent many months working the lake?
Objection, relevance.
What's the relevance to that?
I can ask it slightly differently, Your Honor. I think I phrased it poorly.
Okay.
Hearing that after months focused on the lake, did that redirect your attention to a different area?
Immediately.
Can you explain that to the jury, please?
So other people could continue the interest we had with that stump up there. But I went immediately up to Middle Mountain Road as far as I could go. There's a lock gate up there. A lock gate. So I immediately went up there within the hour or so.
Okay.
I went up there. I'm also a tracker, man tracker. I'm looking for fire tracks, human tracks, footprints, things like that.
And did you, after that, start to focus more efforts to the extent you could in the wintertime on Middle Mountain Road?
I believe all our attention went to Middle Mountain Road at that time.
And then did there come a point in time when the gate opened and the snow melted and a more large-scale search was able to be done on Middle Mountain Road?
Yes. Even before that, we were able to obtain a key to the Forest Service gate. I was going up on a daily basis. And then when June came around, we put on, I don't know the date, 22nd maybe.
Okay.
We put on a very large-scale operation.
Thank you. If you could sit down, sir. So I want to direct your attention back to the pillowcase that we talked about. And we're turning back the clock here a little bit. You had first received the pillowcase. You had asked the defendant if you could take it from his home on November 19th of 2012?
That's correct.
How many days did you continue to try to work with it?
Right up to the time where you decided to do a test.
Was that a few days, maybe 5 days roughly?
Yes, I don't remember exactly how many days. But
roughly a week?
Quite a few days.
Okay. And then if it was roughly a week, was that also prior to the search warrant on the defendant's home? If you don't remember, that's okay.
I believe so.
You feel comfortable with roughly a week?
Yes.
At that point, did you start to have some suspicions?
I did, and I brought those suspicions up to one of the investigators.
Okay. Did your search and rescue team share your concerns?
I was the one working the pillowcase.
Right. When you informed them of what had happened so far in trying to work the pillowcase, collectively, did your team have an idea to check that pillowcase?
Objection as to what people know collectively.
Well, the question ended up being, was there an idea developed from that collective discussion? Did you have an objection to that?
No.
Thank you.
Was an idea developed to check whether Dylan Stent was in fact on that pillowcase?
It started with myself and some of the investigators, and then it grew from there.
And did you have discussions with the search and rescue team about how you might be able to check whether Dylan Stent was on that pillowcase?
Yes, we had a mutual conversation.
Okay. Now, I'm going to ask you some specific questions, but I am also going to stop you from answering some questions because there'll be another witness to talk about the specifics of that. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So what was the general plan related to checking whether Dylan Stent was going to be on that pillowcase?
Basically, we wanted to test the validity that pillowcase did indeed
hold on,
have.
Hold on, there's an objection.
Okay. Well, I was going to see where this went, but it's so far off in the 702 information. This requires expert dog handler credentials and certifications, which are lacking from Mr. Vreeland.
Right, if they get to the ultimate question, which my understanding is that they're not. They're just setting up what happened later, and then the other witness is going to testify about it. Is that your plan?
Yes, Your Honor.
All right.
This testimony involves specialized training in observing and understanding how dogs are used. You informed that this witness would not be asked to provide information on that issue. So,
no, I don't think so. I mean, with the next person that testifies about this, I agree. This is just what the plan was and what they were going to try and do. And I think that's fine.
So if the plan involves anything that's scientific, technical, or any other specialized knowledge, we object. And if the court prefers, I can make a standing objection.
Well, no, I'm not going to let you make a standing objection. You're objecting at this time. This should be the end of it once the plan is developed. And I'm telling you, this does not take – I mean, that's all going to come in later. This is what the plan was. It's not providing any evidence to the jury in terms of what the results were. So you're overruled. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, Mr. Vreeland, was there a plan?
Yes, we developed a plan.
Did the plan involve using the pillowcase itself?
Yes, it did.
And then did the plan involve using some known sense articles from Dylan Redwine?
Yes.
And were some of Dylan Redwine's known sense articles provided to search and rescue from his family members?
Yes, they were asked to send some known sense articles down.
And did search and rescue team receive those bagged up and brought to the plan, the experiment?
Yeah, they went to
facts, not in evidence.
Overruled.
You can continue.
Yeah, those sent articles. I don't know the whole chain of custody, but they wound up going to a gentleman named Tom McNamara who worked for the county / search and rescue.
So, and basically, did multiple people from search and rescue come to the experiment?
So by chance, there was a search and rescue meeting on the second floor of the county building that night. We did the test on the first floor.
Okay. And so, for example, Tom McNamara, Butch Knowlton, and others, are those members of the search and rescue team?
Yes.
Is there someone named Ray Dreeves, who now goes by Ray Randolph after being married, who was also part of that team?
Yes.
Did these various people come together and search and rescue had items from Dylan's home, and then also you had the pillowcase yourself?
Correct.
And these items were brought together into that first floor area is what you're talking about?
Correct. It's an exhibit hall in the county building.
And then, generally speaking, you brought the same pillowcase that you'd received from the defendant in the same condition that you kept it?
Nobody touched it except me.
And that was with gloves and bag?
Correct.
And then McNamara, Knowlton, those guys brought the other items from the family?
Yeah.
And then as you got these items together, can you just tell the jury, was there another canine that did the work in this case other than yours?
Correct. There was another canine.
Had you decided on the canine that might have the skill set for this type of work?
Yes, a dog we all knew very well.
And is that the trailing work that would have translated to what you would do in this instance?
Correct.
And then without getting into the details of it, I'll have the other witness do that, but were you present for those articles being used in that experiment there at the warehouse?
I was present.
Did you ever use the pillowcase again for search efforts after that was done?
After that night, no.
I want to ask you about a few more things. So you talked about doing searches for quite some time. Is it fair to say you've been involved in hundreds of searches regarding Dylan Redwine?
Yes.
I'd like to just bring to your attention a few specific searches. This is just a foundation for some of them that'll later be cross-referenced with the others so that the jury has a picture for all the searches done. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I won't ask you about every search you've done, but I'm going to ask you about a few that will go in with the ones that law enforcement is doing as well so they can all be compiled. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
So at this time, Your Honor, I'm going to ask you to approach this people's 493, 494, 495, and 509.
You may.
So I've provided defense counsel with these, and now I'm showing them to you, sir. Have you seen People's Exhibits 493, 494, 495, and 509 before?
I have.
Do they have areas of the Middle Mountain Road area and of the Vallecito area that are highlighted?
They do.
And do they also have dates on them?
Yes, they do.
Are those fair and accurate pictures of the highlights of the searches that you did on those particular dates?
Yes, they are.
Your Honor, at this time, I'd move to admit People's Exhibit 493, 494, 495, and 509 into evidence.
Mr. Moran? They'll be admitted.
May I publish, Your Honor?
Yes.
So behind you, sir, I'm going to put up these searches so you can just explain to the jury, by way of example, a few of the searches that you did in this case. We'll start with 493. Is this from November 19th of 2012?
Yes, it is.
So this would have been the night that Dylan was reported missing and the night that you were out till 1 a.m.?
That's correct.
And is this kind of the general area that you were searching, both with your dog and with your eyes and with the flashlight and all those things?
Yes, it is.
We move to 494. Now, this is dated November 20th through the 23rd. Is this that next several days in the area that you, search and rescue, volunteers, law enforcement, everyone was searching, looking for Dylan Redwine?
Yes, it is.
And move to 495. Now, this is dated similarly, but it's a little further out. What's additional on this map as we move further out that's highlighted? Draw your attention to Middle Mountain Road.
Yeah, in green.
Yeah, since they used a different color.
Yeah.
And were there some efforts made just along the roadside, basically?
Yes.
What could be done at that time?
Wherever we could.
And then finally, 509.
Yeah, that's...
And then again on 509, does that show in a highlighted pink there another one of the searches that was done?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to go back to People's Exhibit 22, please. Now, we're looking at a very big area here, and I only showed you a couple of specific searches to put together for that compilation later, but is it fair to say that in the years since Dylan Redwine went missing that you searched all over the place up there by Vallecito?
Absolutely.
And is that in conjunction with law enforcement and volunteers and everything
yes,
like that?
Yes.
When you were doing searches up there, are we talking about just walking around in the woods, or are we talking about organized man and woman next to man and woman combing, not
yes.
bleeding?
I'm going to allow it. Go ahead.
Yeah, yes, it did.
What does it look like when you're out there with boots on the ground searching an area?
Just a massive amount of manpower, a massive amount of time, and some very rugged terrain. And yes, there's times when we do arm's length searches, grid patterns. That's the beauty of dogs. A dog is a tool. It's an enhancement tool. And it'll, so if you don't have the manpower, a dog can grid the same area in less time.
Right.
And today we have tracking collars on the dog that records all that as well.
So, and dogs are something that a tool that search and rescue generally has, right?
Yes.
In addition to that, did you get a lot of people out there to use their eyes on sifting through things like that as well?
Yes.
So, Mr. Vreeland, do you know the defendant, Mark Redwine, personally?
I do not.
Had you ever met him prior to this case?
I have not.
Are you someone that follows the media or anything like that, or are you kind of on your own on how you work?
I'm totally on my own. I don't, I don't have a TV.
is search and rescue a part of law enforcement or independent from law enforcement?
It's part of. In La Plata County, the sheriff has ultimate control over.
Okay. And then you and your team who actually do the searching, are you a part of law enforcement, or are you kind of a separate entity that does a separate job?
Search and rescue falls under the sheriff's department.
Okay. Let me ask a different question. Do you have authority as a law enforcement peace officer, for example, to make arrests, things like that, when you're out there working in search and rescue?
I do not. We do not.
And do you build cases against people? Is that part of your role in search and rescue?
It is not.
What is your role? What is your job in search and rescue?
To find people, help people.
And when there's a missing child, what is your job?
Same thing. Find people, find the kiddo.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Mr. Marin?
I get
93. Good afternoon, sir.
Afternoon.
I know that I speak softly on occasion, so let me know if I need to speak up. You've mentioned your hearing deficit. In your experience as a search and rescue official, have you ever searched for someone who was not lost?
Not lost?
Sir. Let me ask it this way. Ever gone looking for a kid who just failed to check in with mom and dad?
Yeah, all the time.
And there was some mention about your observations of the cut of Mr. Redwine's jib, but you've also encountered folks in your experience who are calm in crisis, correct?
Correct.
People who are steady when a problem is occurring, right?
Correct.
And those folks are actually good problem solvers, would you agree?
I would agree.
But you did mention that you could tell Mr. Redwine was concerned, right? You said so on direct.
Yes.
It makes sense to me, and correct me if I'm wrong, but search and rescue professionals are going to have to tell people gently, I suppose, but gently tell folks, you need to stay out of our way. Is that fair?
There are times we have to do that.
And you were not present when someone said that to Mr. Redwine, but are you disagreeing that that's not something he would have been asked?
Repeat that?
Sure. I can ask that better. You would agree that that's the type of thing parents like Mr. Redwine might be informed?
Correct.
So, to the start, shortly after you get the page, you're at Mr. Redwine's house, right?
Correct.
And it's still light out, correct?
Yeah, it's getting dark.
Sure. Dusk. Deputy Potthoff arrived right about when you did, and you approached the house together, correct?
Correct.
It was Deputy Potthoff who knocked on the door, fair?
Yes.
And then there was another deputy, a Deputy Blevins. Do you recall that?
I do not.
But nonetheless, you were invited into the home, were you not?
Correct.
And it was Deputy Potthoff who initiated the conversation with Mr. Redwine. Is that fair?
That's correct.
And they would have had, and forgive me, I'm not certain the terms of art that are used here, but sort of situational control. Sheriff's office in a situation like this is the lead. Is that fair?
That was correct that night.
And Deputy Potthoff was in uniform, right?
Yes.
You were not. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And the conversation was initiated by Deputy Potthoff. Is that right?
That's correct.
And you at some point had to interject to ask for the pillowcase. Is that right?
I asked for a scent article.
And specifically, you motioned to the pillowcase and requested the pillowcase, right?
Yes.
The conversation between Deputy Potthoff and Mr. Redwine was making you impatient because you have a different goal. You want to get out and start searching, right?
Correct.
And Deputy Potthoff is collecting information from Mr. Redwine, right?
Correct.
And that's delaying this process where minutes count that's important to you, right?
Correct.
And so that's why you had to interject.
Correct.
And the pillowcase was on the living room couch, is that right?
It was on a pillow on the living room couch.
And Mr. Redwine, of course, agreed to allow you to take that pillowcase, right?
Yes.
It wasn't his idea. You gestured to it.
Yes.
With respect to the image that's behind you, to People's Exhibit 493, that area there is east of Mr. Redwine's home, right?
Yes, predominantly, yes.
So if you go to the south from his home on County Road 500, you will encounter a bridge, correct?
Yes.
And it's marked on this map. It's called North Bridge Road. Is that right?
Correct.
And the house that's the most prominent there up on the right, it's white, it's outside of the purple searched area. Do you see what I'm talking about? To the northeast of the bridge. If I may, I'll point to it.
Please do.
In your years working in the area, have you become acquainted with the folks who live there?
I don't personally know them, but I know the house.
Are you aware of the marked trail that is at approximately that house that the trail signs lead to the waterfall that's up that way?
Yes.
Okay. And if you continue up that way, you'll make it to Middle Mountain Road, right?
Difficult.
You wouldn't need ropes and helmets. You don't have to rappel in, do you?
No, you wouldn't.
But that wasn't an area searched, at least in the search noted on this exhibit, right?
Right, not that night.
So you mentioned this on direct a little bit, but on November 19th, you're at Mr. Redwine's house with a trailing dog, right?
Yes.
And that dog, you trained to follow the scent. So you start off with a scent source, and then the dog can follow a trail left by whatever is on that scent source. Is that right?
Yeah.
So then the idea here was that with the pillowcase, the dog would smell the pillow and then identify if there was a trail leading that smelled like that pillow did, right?
Correct.
And when that happened, the dog took you down County Road 500, right?
A very little ways.
There's been some disagreement about this. Investigator Goldbright says that the dog went all the way to the North Bridge. Is that right?
Yes.
But your later correction of that was that the dog went 100 yards down the road. Is that right?
Correct.
Your dog that you were doing this with, Cayenne, that's the name of the dog, right?
Correct.
That dog was not certified in trailing. Is that right?
Correct.
And then you mentioned this other dog, and I imagine it's a little opaque for the jury, but that something was happening at the fairgrounds with this other dog, and you said that that was a trailing dog as well, right?
Correct.
But what you were observing at the fairgrounds was a scent identification lineup, correct?
Correct.
And in your experience, working around folks who handle these dogs, and I understand that later you did seek certification for dogs, those are two different disciplines, right? There's trailing and there's scent identification, lineup, smelling, right?
Objection. Objection. And Judge, just because we weren't able to explore these types of topics, I would ask the court make the same ruling that we do it through the witness who's going to come later.
Well, I think this is slightly different than that. If he knows, is it a different discipline? Is it a different training? Excuse me, I'm away from the microphone.
Same training. Please. Yes, answer please.
Is it a different discipline than trailing?
It's the same training in essence.
Okay. Thank you. You can follow up if you need to, Mr. Moran.
In essence, sir, you would disagree with me that they are two different skill sets that a dog would need specific training in.
And I disagree with you.
So on November 19th, 2012, you followed a trail that you thought at the time was Dylan Redwine's trail, correct?
I picked it up at the cattle guard on Mr. Redwine's property, and then it gradually dissipated. I walked as far as the North Bridge. I did not have scent at the North Bridge. That's my turnaround point.
You actually, at one point, were saying that the scent went off, quote, off the porch and to the end of the driveway at the cattle guard. Do you remember that?
Yes.
So it's not just at the cattle guard at the end of the driveway. It's from the porch to the cattle guard and from the cattle guard down towards the North Bridge, right?
Heading that direction.
And the term of art you use with Cayenne is that the dog was in scent. Is that the right language?
At the location of the driveway.
In scent means that the dog was on the trail of the scent originating from the scent particle.
Okay.
The pillowcase,
now, are you going
right?
to qualify him as an expert? Because that part, I think, is expert testimony, and I think Mr. Johnson's previous objection would stand at this point.
Sir, if I may, I'll change gears here a little bit. You mentioned a cofferdam, and I'm not certain everybody knows what that is. But what initiates the cofferdam is that your dog alerted on a stump at the lake. Is that right?
That's correct.
And your dog was indicating the smell of what? Okay. Fair to say that your dog caused you to have interest in a stump at the lake cofferdam?
Objection, Judge, and really because I can't pursue this based on defense's objection, I think it needs to stop here.
Your Honor, if I may, the prosecution did inquire after the cofferdam was created because of dog alerts at the lake, and the implication has been created that that was done because of the fishing pole.
I'm going to let you go there. I don't remember the cofferdam. I do remember the stump. So I'm sure it's in there. It's just that I don't remember it. So I'll let you go into it a little bit, but not too far. Go ahead.
So without getting anything into anything that requires specialized training or knowledge, did you or were you with another handler who represented themselves as having a dog that could identify the smell of cadaver?
In which incident?
I'm talking about before the cofferdam was created at the lake.
Okay, I'm just confirming that. Another dog was brought in prior to my dog being brought in. I never met that dog or person that indicated at the stump.
And after these dogs alert to the stump, a cofferdam was created, correct?
Correct.
The idea of creating this cofferdam was that there was reason to believe there might be a body at that location, correct?
The reason the cofferdam was constructed was because the lake was coming up for the spring and the stump would have been underwater very shortly. So we sandbagged an area around it to delay that action till we could retrieve the material that the dog hit on.
So you brought in 11 firefighters from your crew, right?
Correct.
Filled sandbags and made that cofferdam?
Correct.
While your firefighters filled sandbags and created the dam, Sheriff's Office personnel supervised, is that right?
Correct.
And after the dam was constructed, a backhoe was brought in to scoop mud. Were you there for that?
Yes, I was.
And one of those scoops turned up a wad of blonde hair. Do you remember that?
Yes, it was actually, the machine didn't pull it up. It was stuck on the stump.
And your dog was repeatedly hitting on that hair, right?
Just one time. The dog, yeah, once the dog hits,
I'm going to stop the hitting. I mean, the whole part, I was going to let you get into this because of what happened. I think that's appropriate. You talked about the hair, but anything else about dogs done now for this area?
The next morning, you returned with your dog, and the dog hit on that stump.
This area is done with dogs, is what I just ruled. I wish you would listen to me.
I thought that was with respect to the hair. I'm listening. I beg your pardon. I didn't realize it was in general. Switching gears here. When you went into Mr. Redwine's house on November 19th, you did not observe any blood, right?
That's correct.
There were no signs of struggle, right?
I wasn't looking for anything like that.
You did notice, though, what you thought was a lot of alcohol bottles.
Correct.
And you thought Mr. Redwine looked like a drinker.
I did initially say that, yes.
Did you smell cigarette smoke in the house?
Yes.
How about bleach?
No, I don't recall the bleach.
Were you able to smell pine sol?
I don't recall.
You didn't smell ammonia, right?
I don't recall.
You didn't smell vinegar?
Don't recall.
There was no overwhelming smell of cleaning products in that house, was there?
I don't recall.
Would that stand out to you, having gone in the house and observed strong odor of cleanup?
Possibly.
You didn't see a bucket with a bloody mop, did you?
I don't recall.
You didn't observe garbage cans
overflowing with I'm not going to let you, I mean, he didn't see anything. That's what he's testified to. I'm not going to let you go through every possible thing. We're going to move on with this case. If you want to talk to me, saw anything about that indicated the cleanup, that's fine. But that's pretty much where you're going to end.
Sir, there were no items that looked like they'd been used to absorb or wipe up blood. Is that right?
I went in with the full intention of looking for a scent article that belonged to Dylan.
Okay. And while you're looking around the room and looking at things like chargers and the pillow, you did not observe anything that indicated to you that had been used to mop up blood, right?
I don't recall. Yeah.
That's something that would stand out to you, though. That's the type of thing you probably would recall had you observed it, don't you think?
Possibly.
In addition to that pillow that was in Mr. Redwine's house, having the scent that you were looking for on the 19th, the fact that it came out of Mr. Redwine's house would have meant it had his scent on it as well, right?
Possibly.
And prior to tracking the scent down to the North Bridge, you walked Mr. Redwine's property several times, didn't you?
I worked his property numerous times.
You recall that night specifically walking the property several times, and if not, I have a document that I think I can use to refresh your recollection.
Repeat that?
Sure. Do you remember that night that you walked the property several times? If you don't remember, I can refresh
your recollection. No, I absolutely remember. It's a tiny parcel of land.
And by the property, you obviously mean the property of Mr. Redwine.
That's correct.
And that dog scented on something that had been in Mr. Redwine's house. It didn't take you from the pillow to Mr. Redwine, right?
That's correct.
One of the risks with the temperature that you noted starting in the mid to low 40s and then dropping is that that creates a risk of hypothermia. Agreed?
Correct.
Do you recall a couple of years later that on November 2nd of 2015, you accompanied searchers up Middle Mountain Road to look for what was later found and determined to be the partial cranium of Dylan Redwine?
What was the date?
November 2nd, 2015.
I remember.
And you had your dog trained to identify the smell of cadaver or human bones with you, right?
Correct.
Objection, Your Honor. Mr. Moran?
That's as much as they didn't find anything. That's as much as I need to ask about it.
Yeah, I don't think, you know, you can't, that's the speaking objection. Although that wasn't an objection. That's the kind of thing that upsets me about speaking objection. That's something that I don't believe is in the record. That's something you can't get into. This witness has not been qualified as a cadaver dog expert. So you're to ignore that last response or the last question from Mr. Moran, but it's not evidence anyway, so you should be ignoring it. So move on.
Ms. Foster, the citizen who found that partial cranium, took you to where she found it, right?
Correct.
And you participated in a search that went on for 4.5 hours, is that correct?
Objection, Your Honor. These are the same questions and the same line of questions where the objection was just sustained.
Mr. Moran?
I'm not asking about what the dog was doing. I'm asking about what the team did.
Well, you can ask. If you limit it to that, I guess it's okay. So did your team search for 4.5 hours or 4 hours, whatever the question was? Did you search for 4 hours, the team?
I don't recall the exact time, but it was quite a while.
It was what?
It was quite a while.
All right. Mr. Moran?
Would it refresh your recollection to take a look at a report describing how many hours? I'm sorry, that wasn't loud enough, I suspect. Would it refresh your recollection to take a look at a report about that day?
Thank you.
Permission to approach?
Yes.
Page 5994.
Can the parties or witnesses approach, please? Whenever you're ready, Mr. Mann.
Your Honor, on this same topic, I'd ask to approach.
All right.
ahead, Mr. Moran.
Mr. Vreeland, in addition to there being discussion about a fishing pole, there was also some generalized interest in the lake by dogs. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
And if I may, I'd ask to approach the witness.
Sure.
Can I see those, please? Judge, based on the conversation that we just had at the bench, I'm going to object to these. I think the question that was discussed was asked, and we should be moving on. And this is going to go right down the line of questioning that we just talked about.
Well, if you want to tender it as an exhibit that I won't admit because of our last conversation, that's fine. Well, sure. Will both of you come up?
Sir, thank you. Sir, if I could have you take a look at Defendant's Exhibit 1228 and 1229. You had sufficient time to look at those?
Yes.
And can you tell the ladies and gentlemen of the jury what that is?
It's a photo of...
And hold on, please.
I'm going to ask it differently when the court catches up, so.
Well, I'd be caught up, but I don't have this on the list. Okay, go ahead.
Do you recognize what's going on here?
Yes.
And are these images a fair and accurate depiction of something that you observed while you were participating in searches?
Yes.
And is it fair to say that what's
going on in 1227. Sorry, that's 1229.
And I'll stipulate the 1228 and 1229 if that makes it easier.
And we'll admit 1228 and 1229.
Commissioner, publish.
Has denied 1227, so go ahead.
Permission to publish 1228, 1229, 1228.
Yes.
And what the jury will see here in a moment is that these divers are out at a buoy in the lake, right?
Correct.
And that was a buoy that was dropped out there because of generalized interest in the water from a dog. Is that right?
Numerous dogs.
Okay. And those dogs were saying, well,
that's enough.
1229. Same thing, a diver out in the water, and the reason divers were sent out there was because of the generalized interest in the lake by these dogs, right?
Correct.
So a few more questions, if I may, sir. Okay, to take that down, thank you. You mentioned seeing Mr. Redwine out in front of his house. I believe that would have been on the 20th of November. Am I remembering right?
Correct.
You weren't in front of the house the entire time, though, were you?
Approximately 5 hours.
Were you moving about and searching, or you were just doing...
I was stationary in a command vehicle.
And Mr. Redwine stayed out there the whole time?
He wasn't out there initially, but then he came out later on.
You mentioned at some point that you were up on the mountain, on Middle Mountain, and I believe you said you were maybe on cross-country skis or on snowshoes. Is that right?
Correct.
And that was before the gate was opened. Is that right?
Correct.
So that was before April of 2012, right?
April of 2013.
I beg your pardon. Thank you. Yes, sir. So in the wintertime of 2012 and 2013, you had directed some resources up onto Middle Mountain. Is that right?
Yes, limited, but yes.
Moment, please. Thank you, sir. That's all my questions.
Redirect.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, Mr. Vreeland, I'm going to hone in on some of the topics raised by defense counsel, okay?
Yes.
One of those was asking you about the Pello case. And I think counsel correctly stated that you actually had to ask Mark Redwine for that Pello case. He didn't offer it to you.
Right. I saw it and I asked.
Was that after you'd gone through a series of items that would work for scent trailing?
Yes, it was.
And he said he didn't have any of them.
Correct.
And then you had to point out the Pello case, and then he gave it to you.
Yes, I asked who slept there.
So he didn't offer you, here's a Pello case to search for my son.
That's correct.
Asked and answered.
It was.
Now, do you recall, Mr. Vreeland, how the conversation went in terms of whether there were any of Dylan's possessions left in the residence?
Mr. Redwine, Mark Redwine, stated that there was nothing of Dylan's in the house.
And do you recall, would it refresh your recollection to look at a report from 2013 as to specifically how the defendant answered that question?
I'd like to see that.
It'll refresh your memory. May I approach with discovery page 705?
Yes, you may, but Mr. Moran?
Your Honor, there was no testimony about failing to recollect. This is improper refreshing.
You have to speak up so I can understand you.
Beg your pardon. This is improper refreshing. There was no testimony about a failure to remember.
I'm going to allow it to happen. We'll see if this changes this. Go ahead.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Yes.
Mr. Freeland, I'm just going to direct your attention to this paragraph. And if you could read that paragraph, particularly the second sentence, which that refreshes
What paragraph is Council referring to?
Fifth paragraph, Council, on page 705 of the
schedule. Your Honor, may we approach on this?
Why not?
Did you have a minute?
And go back to your microphone. Oh, okay.
Yes.
So, sir, did reviewing that paragraph refresh your recollection as to the details of that conversation with Mr. Redwine about the pillowcase?
Yes, it did.
And what kind of sense did you get in terms of his response to you about Dylan's possessions being gone when the question was asked?
At the time it almost appeared that he knew there was nothing in the house before I asked the question.
He seemed prepared for the question.
Yes.
Objection, speculation, move to strike this question last.
I'll strike the second question, the second answer. Move on, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Your Honor. You were asked about
the jury can't rely upon the second answer that he just made. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. So I want to move on to a different topic. There was a lot of talk about the lake, right?
Correct.
Let me just ask you, do you know if anyone's drowned in that lake before?
There has been over the years.
Now, would you agree with me that there are good dogs and bad dogs in terms of scent work?
I tend to feel that there are good handlers and bad handlers.
Oh, great. I see what you're saying. There are some handlers out there that have no idea what they're doing.
I agree.
Are there also some handlers that are very good?
Very, very good.
Now, you were asked some questions along the lines of why you were at the lake, but you tell us. From day one, what put the lake at issue for you?
The lake started with the initial interview with Mark Redwine on the 19th of November 2019, when he directed a lot of attention towards Dylan's liking of fishing, especially at the dam of the lake.
And then was there further information with regard to the fishing pole that impacted the investigation?
Absolutely. That came up about his fishing pole missing out of the garage.
So counsel asked you about a lot of the efforts going on down at the lake, right?
Correct.
And that included some dogs, and that included some divers.
Correct.
But why did all that get started, and why were all those resources down there in the first place?
Ask and answer. This is twice on redirect and multiple times on direct.
I think it's been covered. I should move on.
Thank you, Your Honor. The last topic I'll ask you about is that counsel asked you if some people are calm under pressure. You recall that line of questioning?
I do.
And is it fair to say that in your years in search and rescue, you've seen people at different levels of excitability?
Absolutely.
Did this case stand out to you in terms of the defendant's demeanor and reaction?
Absolutely.
Ask and answer. Retreading this ground is not necessary. Ask and answer.
why hasn't this already, didn't you already do this on direct?
It was done in cross-examination, Your Honor, with respect to a calm demeanor as opposed to an excited demeanor, only covering it with a couple of questions.
All right.
Did it stand out to you in this instance specifically?
Yes, it did.
And then would you agree with me that there's a difference between being calm but being invested in the process of finding your son and being calm and being disinterested?
Objection. Relevance, the witness has testified on this issue several times, or asked and answered territory.
I disagree. This is relevant in terms of being invested into the process or not, and maybe it's been slightly covered, but this is a more direct question, so go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, Mr. Vreeland, would you agree with me that there's a difference between being calm but still invested in the process of finding your loved one or being calm and disinterested in that process?
Yeah, I agree with your first.
Which was the defendant?
Yes.
Which of those was the defendant? Calm and interested in helping to find his son, or calm and disinterested?
Objection. Leading.
No, yes. It's fine.
Disinterested.
Disinterested.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions from the jury? One of those times I forgot Aaron's not a machine. So, in any event, Mr. Vreeland, the jury has asked, so answer the question to the jury. How maintained or used would the trail have been leading to the waterfall at that time, if you know?
I don't know.
Okay. And they didn't hear it, so look at them.
I'm sorry.
I don't know.
Any other questions from the jury? And any, I guess there's no follow-up then. This one is to be excused?
Yes, Your Honor.
Fine, thank you.
All right, thank you very much, Mr. Vreeland. Vreeland, you're free to go. Next witness.
People called Daniel ABDELLA to the stand.
Up to the witness stand, please. Raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm under penalty of perjury the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Have a seat.
Hello, sir.
Morning.
Hello. Can you introduce yourself to the jury, please?
Yes, my name is Daniel ABDELLA.
And how do you spell your last name?
ABDELLA.
What do you do, sir?
I'm a patrol supervisor for the Bayfield Marshal's Office.
And what's your rank at the Bayfield Marshal's Office?
Sergeant.
Sergeant. How long have you been working at the Bayfield Marshal's Office?
Roughly 11 years.
I want to turn your attention directly to this case. Did you come to have a meeting with Mark Redwine regarding Dylan Redwine being missing?
Yes, I did.
Do you recall the date of that meeting?
November 19th, 2012.
And do you recall the rough time that that meeting occurred?
Approximately 5 p.m. in the evening.
Okay. How did that meeting come to take place?
Mr. Redwine came to the side door of the marshal's office, knocked, and I answered. And that's how we met.
Does the marshal's office connect in with a normal dispatch system?
Yes.
And was there any phone call preceding this meeting?
No, there was not.
And did you receive any information about this meeting from dispatch?
No, sir, I didn't.
How did the conversation proceed?
Mr. Redwine basically asked me if I had seen his son on my patrol during the day, and I told Mr. Redwine I wasn't sure who his son was at that time and who he was actually when we were talking.
So you'd never met him before?
No, sir.
Did you, and had you ever met Dylan Redwine before?
No.
Did you have any idea that you were supposed to be looking for his son?
No, that was the first I had heard about it.
Had he reported Dylan Redwine missing prior to this encounter with you, to the best of your knowledge?
Not to my knowledge, no.
Did he bring a photograph of Dylan Redwine to show you?
No, he did not.
Did he give you any kind of description of Dylan Redwine while he was there at the Bayfield Marshal's office?
No, he didn't.
So he basically asked you if you had seen him. I think that's what you testified to?
Correct.
Okay. And again, how did that strike you in the moment?
Just as a question, if I knew them, I might have seen them on patrol, but I didn't know either one of them. So, again, I wasn't looking for them. So, it was just a question.
Okay. To your knowledge, had Mr. Mark Redwine, made any efforts to reach out to Dylan Redwine's mother before coming to the Bayfield Marshal's office?
No, he did not.
And did you direct him on that topic in any particular way?
I mentioned to him it might be a good idea to reach out to see if she had heard anything from Dylan.
Okay. And while he was there with you, did you witness him do that?
I believe he texted her. I don't know what the reply or response was.
Okay. You didn't see the text?
No, sir, I did not.
Okay. When someone comes in a situation like this where they're looking for someone that they don't know where they are, what are the normal steps that you as a law enforcement officer would take?
A lot of the basic things. I'd like to get their full name, their date of birth, what the person was last seen wearing, when they last had contact with this person, any friends, relatives, anything pertinent that I can get out to the law enforcement community to help find or search for said person.
And transmitting that information out to the law enforcement community, what's that process called?
That's called an ATL, which is an attempt to locate.
Did you offer Mr. Redwine the opportunity to do an ATL in this case?
Yes, I did.
And how did he respond?
He did not want to do that at the time.
He did not want to do that?
Did not.
Is an ATL the same thing as a missing persons report?
In the action, you know, the what it is itself is, yes, the names are obviously different, but it goes to dispatch, it's aired to all the law enforcement agencies, and then that's where it kind of starts.
So, and that would that require you to enter all that data into your system, open a case, open a report, et cetera?
Right, a case would be open. That information that I gathered would be then given to central dispatch, and they would air it out to the community.
Did you explain to Mr. Redwine what an ATL was?
Yes, I did.
And the process that it begins?
Yes.
And again, he declined. Is that correct?
Correct. He did not want to do that.
But you only asked him that once. It wasn't like over and over again.
Right. I understand.
Okay. In your experience as a law enforcement officer, have you had situations similar to this where a parent is unable to locate a child and they come to law enforcement for help?
Yes.
What, in your experience, what's the usual demeanor that you observe in the situations?
Objection, Your Honor, relevance. This is a 702 issue as well. If we're going to have profile or testimony, then that needs to be endorsed and litigated beforehand. Objection.
Okay. Your standing objection will be noted. It's the same as a previous witness. I think this is not specialized knowledge that requires a 702 analysis. I think the jury can understand this testimony without that qualification. So you're overruled. Your objection stands for as long as it goes on with this witness. Go ahead.
Thank you. The question was, what's the typical demeanor of a parent who comes to report a missing child?
Most are a little nervous and concerned. They can't find their children, obviously. That's it, really. Concern and a little nervous.
How would you describe Mr. Redwine's demeanor?
Calm.
Okay. Did he seem concerned?
A little. I mean, he was talking with me about it, so there was a little concern there, but yeah.
Did it strike you as unusual that he did not display the typical demeanor that you described?
Asked and answered.
Overruled. Go ahead.
Yes.
Okay. I don't have any further questions for you.
All right, sir. Mr. Marin?
Thank you, Your Honor. My approach, I want to provide the witness with a copy of his report.
Yes.
Officer Abdella, testify from your memory as much as possible and only refer to it if requested.
Okay. Okay, sir. Sergeant Abdella, I'm saying that right, Sergeant?
You are, sir. Thank you.
Sergeant now. Having attained your advanced rank, it's fair to say that you have had lots of experience, training, otherwise, in writing reports.
Correct. Yes, sir.
And
objection, relevance, be on the scale.
Well, maybe it's relevant. I'll see where it goes. And I know it's beyond the scope, but I think it probably is going. I think I'll respond. I think it's okay.
Sir, you understand that reports are critical pieces of information in the criminal justice system.
I do, yes.
You understand that individuals like His Honor Judge Wilson read police reports, right?
Correct.
And that they're provided to the prosecution and ultimately to defense counsel. You understand that?
Yes, I do.
And you understand that it's important to note all of the critical details in a report. Agreed?
Yes, I do.
And that was something you even understood back in 2012, right?
Correct.
It's drilled into people at police academy, correct?
Yes.
And it's something that impacts your ability to advance as a police officer, your ability to write reports that properly summarize the important details in an investigation.
Correct, yes.
If you would, and take your time with this, so I'd like you to read your report that I've provided for you from November 19, 2012, and let me know when you get to the part about having discussed an ATL with Mr. Redwine.
That is not in my initial report.
On November the 19th, 2012, was that the first time someone asked you as a law enforcement official about a 13-year-old they had not seen for a while?
At that point, to my recollection, yes.
Yeah. So you'd been a police officer then for about 8 years and nobody had talked to you about a missing 13-year-old?
No.
How about just missing teenagers in general?
Yes, I've had several people ask me that before.
And one of the things law enforcement officials are trained is that if you're at the house of a kid that's missing, is that you want to look through the house because maybe the kid's somewhere in the house. Is that fair?
Correct.
And would agree that occasionally parents become concerned that they haven't heard from a child and that child is with their friend. Is that something you've encountered as a law enforcement official?
Yes.
In fact, in this very case, you yourself figured Dylan was most likely, quote, at a friend's house and would show up sooner or later, right?
It's always a possibility, sir, yes.
And that was a conclusion that you reached after having met with Mr. Redwine, right?
Based on the report, yes.
To the extent it may have been unclear on direct, you would agree that you were provided a description of the child, right?
I was provided? No, I was not provided.
Well, you were given his age. You were given a description of what he looked like, right?
I got an age, sir.
Okay. When you were approached by this citizen saying that they couldn't find their child, you didn't inquire as to what the child was wearing?
No, not initially.
Didn't inquire after any further description of the child aside from their date of birth?
No, sir.
But you did get Dylan's phone number?
I believe we had that phone number when we were talking, Mr. Yeah. and Mr. Redwine.
And you called Dylan, right?
Correct.
And you said, Dylan, your father's looking for you. He's worried, right?
Correct.
Told Dylan to call his dad, right?
Correct.
You gave Mr. Redwine your card and told him to call you if he needed anything further. Is that right?
Yes, sir, it is.
And despite your testimony that you described to Mr. Redwine what an attempt to locate is, you didn't write anything about that, right?
No, I did not.
And you would agree that given you're here testifying about it now, that's an important detail. One that if it happens should be written down, right?
Correct.
Would you agree that sometimes, and you did say on direct that Mr. Redwine was concerned. Did I hear that correctly?
Yes.
And you would agree that sometimes concerned parents contact law enforcement officials and the kid's just late coming home. Yes?
That's, yeah, yes.
Or being disrespectful, right? Not letting mom and dad know where they are, right?
Yes.
That's something that you would consider as a possibility.
Yes.
When was the report that I've provided to you, when was that written in relation to November 19th, 2012?
That I cannot
recollect. But it was not written the same day, was it?
No, sir, it was not.
And that's why you had to approximate the time that Mr. Redwine came in concerned about his child, right?
Right.
And was this report written after you were approached by sheriff's office investigators who were transitioning from the kids hanging out with his friends to we've got a problem?
Was it written before or after?
It was after they realized that this is getting to be more serious.
It was before.
Okay. But you don't know when?
No, sir, I don't.
Was it a week, a month? Can you estimate?
I couldn't honestly estimate a solid time, sir, no.
Who contacted you asking you to write the report?
This one in front of me?
Yes, sir.
Nobody contacted me. I wrote it myself.
Would you agree that failing to create a contemporaneous report could have endangered your job?
Can you rephrase the question?
Sure. That when there is a missing child and a report was not written right at the time the parent came to law enforcement, would you agree that that's a problem as a law enforcement official?
It is if the person that is reporting wants to file a report.
Okay. So your assessment was this wasn't serious enough to necessitate a report, so you didn't have to write one at that point?
No, sir, that's not correct. I did not do a report. An official report because Mr. Redwine did not want to file an official report.
Okay. And then later you realized a report was a good idea.
Correct.
And when you wrote that report, would you agree that that report, that you were under pressure to get that report right?
I wasn't under pressure to get it right. I just felt that it was something that needed to be documented so I wouldn't forget anything.
You were aware of the prevailing hypothesis of law enforcement at the time that Mr. Redwine had somehow caused his child to go missing. Agreed?
Agreed, yes.
And in writing that report, you understood that that not supporting the prevailing hypothesis might implicate your job.
Can you please rephrase that question again? I'm not
sure
following that.
Sir, I take no pleasure in these questions, but was there pressure on you having been previously terminated by the La Plata County Sheriff's Office for misconduct?
Was there pressure for me to write the report?
Correct, and to make sure that it matched the prevailing hypothesis?
No, it wasn't.
You didn't feel any extra pressure given
the termination from employment as a law enforcement official you had suffered in the years previous?
No, sir. I was just taking the notes and writing it down.
I want to get this over with quickly, but it's an important issue. You were terminated from the Wapata County Sheriff's Office, is that right?
Yes, I was.
And you were terminated for policy violations, including untruthfulness?
Yes, I was.
And every law enforcement agency, at least that you've worked for, has policy around writing of reports, right?
Correct, yes.
You testified on direct that it stood out to you that Mr. Redwine was inquiring after his son, and you didn't know Mr. Redwine or have any previous encounter of Dylan. Do you remember that line of questioning?
I do, sir.
And if you would, will you turn to your report and let me know where you note in that report that that stood out to you on November 19, 2012?
That I did not know them?
No, that you noted that it stood out to you that this individual was addressing you as if you knew his child when you had never met either of them before.
That's not in my initial report.
You say initial. Were there more reports?
No, the one I wrote.
And the first time there's a report that indicates that stood out as strange to you was one taken by another law enforcement official you spoke with a year after Dylan's disappearance, right?
Yes, sir.
And that was the occasion where you said that, oh, this stood out to me, Mr. Redwine, and why would I know his child, right?
Correct.
And it was in that year that there was a white-hot spotlight on our community, national television program, and all kinds of other attention. Is that right?
Reference the case? Yes.
Does it make any mention in your report that Mr. Redwine did not want you looking for his child?
No, sir.
Moment, please. Thank you, sir. That's all I have.
Reader?
Thank you.
Thank you, Judge. How big is Bayfield?
Probably approximately 2,500 people.
And how would you describe your role within the office?
From day-to-day operations, I supervise all the patrol operations, the training, the equipment, basically the number two, I guess, in the department underneath my chief.
Do you have a lot of citizen encounters?
I do.
Is it uncommon for people to come down to the Bayfield Marshal's office to speak with you?
No, it's very common. It's
Do you write a report about each and every one of those contacts?
No.
Why not?
Most of them are casual conversations from anything to do with anything. If the people want to file a report, then obviously that goes to a different level and we draw a case number and move forward.
Does part of that decision about whether to write a report or not depend on the citizens' level of concern?
Yes.
How does that factor in to this situation with Mark Redwine? as far as not creating an official report for the record, there was no one, he did not want to do that. There was really no concern to do that. Also with the ATL not wanting to be aired, that's basically why.
Would it be fair to characterize this as just another one of the citizen encounters that happens all the time at the Bayfield Marshal's office?
It is.
And on the afternoon of the 19th, you had no idea that this case would end up becoming a much larger investigation.
No, not at all, sir.
And when you realized that it actually was blossoming into a larger situation, how did that factor into your decision to document what happened between you and Mr. Redwine?
Just because I personally felt that it was probably going to get into something bigger, and that before it completely escapes my memory, I should document what I could remember.
Okay. And later, you were actually interviewed as almost as a witness in the case, right?
Correct.
And was that by another law enforcement officer?
It was.
Okay. And Mr. Moran correctly pointed out that was about a year after these initial events occurred, right?
Yes, sir.
Did you still have a good memory of those events?
It was a year, so unfortunately, I remember most of it, but I'm sure there were some things that weren't perfectly remembered.
Sure. And even as you sit here today and testify, do you remember the encounter with Mr. Redwine?
No, nothing other than what was written.
Okay. And the things that are written in there, as well as the interview that you gave, was that to the best of your memory at the time that you made those statements?
It was.
Mr. Moran asked you about this idea that parents report missing teens frequently, that they could be with their friends or maybe somewhere even in the house, right?
Yes.
And when the parent displays a certain amount of lack of concern, that you share that as well. Is that correct?
Correct.
Is that part of what happened in this case? Was Mr. Redwine's lack of concern something that you agreed with or adopted, in fact, in the?
To an extent, I can't force somebody to file a report. I mean, I can't change another person's ideas or what they're feeling about the case or the situation. So I have to go off there.
Do you remember talking with Tanya Goldbright, who interviewed you in the case?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And you remember speaking to her about the influence that Mark Redwine's lack of concern had on your actions?
Yes.
And what do you recall about that?
That he just didn't seem to have any concern about his son being missing at the time that we talked a year ago, or a year from that point.
And that was part of why you didn't write a report follow-up?
Correct.
When you wrote your initial report, did you feel pressure, as described by Mr. Moran, to document it in a certain way?
No, sir, not at all.
And when you interviewed with Tanya Goldbright, did you feel pressure to say certain things?
No, sir, not at all.
Mr. Moran pointed out that you were actually previously terminated by the sheriff's office.
I was.
And you've obviously since been hired by the Bayfield Marshal's office.
Correct.
Do you remember when was that termination? Roughly.
16, 17 years ago?
Okay.
Maybe. It's been a while.
And did that termination have anything to do with a criminal investigation?
No.
It wasn't part of your casework? You weren't being dishonest about a case?
As far as I'm going to let you go about that, on that.
Thank you.
We limited that testimony.
Thank you. And the fact that you had been terminated, did that have any influence on the statement that you gave to Tanya Goldbright or the report that you wrote?
No, not at all.
No further questions for you. Thank you, sir.
Any questions from the jury? Can this witness be excused?
Yes, Your Honor.
I guess you can be excused.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, that question was to both attorneys.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our afternoon recess. We'll take 15 minutes. It's about 3:20 now. We'll start up about 3:35. Please don't talk to each other about the case, and we'll see you in a little bit. Everybody rise.
Are you representing?
Step downstairs, then?
Let me
see. Does it please you?
It's easy to come down.